Now, if you're a pressure group and measure success purely in terms of column inches achieved, then Fathers for Justice must be feeling pretty smug. After all, their flower bombing of Tony Blair in the Commons certainly got them publicity, yards and yards of it. But it led some to wonder out loud if that was their idea of mature protest. Was it any wonder the courts took a dim view of their contact rights, the main cause of their unhappiness? Others, though, said it merely reflected desperation at the state of family law. Today, Fathers for Justice held a rally in London ahead of Father's Day this Sunday. So what drives this group's strategy? Richard Watson gained access to the heart of their operations in the run-up to the march.
That this campaign will change, it will evolve, we will keep chopping and changing the strategy. And I promise you, we will surprise and challenge both the police and the public in the coming months.
In the quiet reaches of the Suffolk countryside lies the nerve centre for perhaps the fastest growing campaign in Britain, Fathers for Justice. Earlier this week, tucked away in the grounds of a 13th century manor, the movement's founder, Matt O'Connor, is finalising plans for the mass rally of disgruntled dads, which took place in London today.
It is all very, 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 the most stressful time, I can remember, yeah, worse than anything we've been through before, put that way. And just trying to cope. In fact, I think I've got some of the guys are coming up this afternoon, and then we've got a full house tomorrow. When it gets to the point where that is likely to be the case, can you obviously ring me and say, look, if I don't get over the next hour or so, I'd like to put a few fireworks up people's backsides, all right? All right, cheers, Steve. Thanks for calling me. Cheers, mate. Yeah, I'll speak to you. Yeah, Matt speaking.
Fathers for Justice is run by Matt and one assistant out of this room. They can barely cope with the increased demand for information, especially after activists flower bombed Tony Blair last month, which created a huge security scare in Parliament.
The Labour Party was forged in the fires of civil disobedience. It's amazing that the party seems to have forgotten its roots.
So no regrets about that?
That categorically not. Oh yeah, and as ever with a Fathers for Justice thing, we always claim, you know, stand up and account for our actions. There's always a bit of humour in it, you know, and condom for obvious reasons. Self-raising flower, again, for obvious reasons. It certainly got them up off their feet anyway, so it worked in that respect.
This stuff is against the law, though, isn't it?
That is the nature of this organisation. We do explore the outer extremities of the law. We do break the law deliberately, and we are prepared to be held to account for that. And whether or not we're right or whether or not we're wrong, you know, it's an old cliche, but let history be our judge, you know.
Matt O'Connor, who launched the group 18 months ago after a messy divorce, drove 50,000 miles last year, mainly, he says, to avoid being monitored by the police. This is a classic tactic for direct action groups to keep law-breaking plans secret. Direct action is the key to the group's fast-growing support. But can he be sure that some supporters won't go way too far? Last weekend, activists claiming to be from Fathers for Justice sabotaged a television transmitter in Shropshire.
It has absolutely categorically nothing to do with us. In fact, I was really annoyed about that because I had my children with me at the time, and given how busy I am at the moment, I want some quiet time, peaceful time with my children. I switched my phone off on Sunday morning because of the number of calls I was getting about this transmitter incident. And obviously, let's face it, hopefully we've got a degree of savvy about us. Who wants to switch off a transmitter in the middle of Euro 2004 and hack off the very people that we're trying to recruit? Duh.
You could get some mavericks out there who do some pretty extreme things that you're not in control of.
Last week we warned Scotland Yard about concerns that we'd had about possible, be it splinter groups or people going off at tangents. There is very little we can do about that, apart from keeping the vast majority of people in this organisation on board and disciplined. And our coordinators sign up to a national coordinators agreement, which I'll happily show you. We have national coordinators meetings, and we run this organisation like a military campaign.
Ah, fantastic. That's really good.
The campaign's focus is beginning to shift from men in tights to more serious policy discussion. Today is a big day. The first copies of Fathers for Justice's so-called blueprint for the complete overhaul of the family law courts is ready. The group says hearings are secretive, costly and take too long, that some women are maliciously blocking contact by inventing allegations of violence or abuse, and that even when courts order contact to go ahead, many women simply refuse to comply, and little is done by the courts to enforce these so-called contact orders.
So, trying to set out a vision, how do we build a fair and just and equitable system of family law, not just for now, but in the next 25 years, and that's what this is about completely starting from scratch. And it's very radical. I mean, I know it's very difficult because government moves very slowly, legislation moves very slowly, but I think that's what's needed is radical reform. And that's what this document says. It's a case for urgent, radical reform.
Are you saying then that the majority of men who aren't given contact, who aren't getting the contact with their kids, are being unjustly denied that contact? You're absolutely clear about that, because obviously some people would argue, look, in many of those cases, they are feckless, they're somehow irresponsible.
It's not just fathers with justice saying it. It's the judges, it's the solicitors, and the politicians increasingly. People are beginning to recognise that our family justice system is failing fathers, it's failing mothers, and it's failing children. It needs to go, and it needs to go now.
Back at the office, they're fine-tuning the campaign.
Oh, yeah. So a bit of...
Fathers for Justice says it's choosing music for superhero dads, ready for today's march in London. But are all the dads who are being denied contact really superheroes, or are some a genuine threat to women and their children, as some campaign groups argue?
Women's groups, on the other hand, are saying in the vast majority of cases when women are denying contact or making contact difficult, there's a very good reason for it, and that's because men are dangerous or they somehow have a negative impact on
their
children.
But that just isn't borne out in any way, shape or form. I've just cited two very high-profile judgments. Yeah, this is about children and about good, loving parents.
What is your view? When there is proven evidence of domestic violence in the family, perpetrated by the man, for example, for argument's sake here, do you think contact should be automatically sanctioned by the court, or do you think it should be supervised contact, or what's the situation?
I think where there's any allegations, and I'm not here to talk about domestic violence, I'm here to talk about family law, and I think let's make a very clear differentiation. If you want to have a debate about domestic violence, have a programme about domestic violence. I'm here to talk about good, loving parents. But there is a point here, is that if the child's at risk from any parent, be it the mother or the father, then obviously the child protection authorities need to step in.
At the march in London today, we spoke to several men who told us they've been denied contact after unsubstantiated allegations of violence or abuse were made. We're legally prevented from reporting these in any detail, which critics say is part of the problem. But campaigners here say that much can be done to improve the family court system. Allegations of abuse should be dealt with swiftly. There should be a presumption of equal parenting duties and contact time, and much tougher enforcement of court contact orders. Currently, 22 members of Fathers for Justice are facing prosecution for public order offences. We were told that if all the key people are arrested, the group will roll out a so-called Plan Zero, widespread civil disobedience similar to the fuel protests which seized Britain's roads.
Our democracy, our parliamentarians have failed not just fathers, not just mothers, they've failed our children. And it's not a problem they haven't known about. They've known about this for years. And I hold this democracy in absolute contempt, frankly.
Protest leaders claim their arguments are slowly gaining ground with solicitors, judges and politicians alike. And they point out that some women, often new partners, support their views. Some of their stunts have attracted serious criticism, but the group maintains that breaking the law is core to their strategy of raising the profile of child contact and family law.